Wait, so anybody does like that, they mind it. That's the problem. It's a very different style of life. They'll never... Have you ever heard any Indian shouting at you? See, it's a very different style of life. Try to understand that. If they have to say, they'll just go and tell them, whisper in the ears that, please don't talk, mother. Now they'll keep quiet. But then, you see, if you shout, anyone, if you shout, shouting is not Indian style. Have you heard anybody shouting? That's what it is. You see, it's a... I have seen that, like, French also, they really quarrel all the time. They talk to each other, feel the ho-ho-ho-ho going. See? And I used to say, how can it be? They said, we talk like that, mother. Nobody minds it. They're used to this kind of thing. One talks with big tension, another talks with big tension. So, one has to understand the system is good in this country. It's not to, as far as possible, to keep your temper within control, your tongue within control, your vishuddhi especially, the right vishuddhi should be kept in proper control. Now, the sweetness and the mindless. And a very soothing behavior, you see, is an expression of love. And as you sort of go deep down within yourself, into a subtler being, you'll find a smooth movement of your sap, of the kundalini, which is nourishing you. It's not volcanic, it is not traumatic, it doesn't come out in a big way. But a very silent movement of the kundalini. It's very soothing, it's very quiet, and moves with tremendous speed, but without any noise, without any bumps. And if there is any bump, it stops for a while. It circuits round that, circles round and goes off. And the pressure of our temperaments or of our nature or of our everything you can say, whatever it is, due to our conditionings, due to our temperaments, any, like anger, some people have pressures of anger, some people have pressures of their habits also. And some people have a kind of a conditioning of vanity. Vanities. Some people have a vanity. Now this vanity is something stupid, and that must be washed all the time. And the vanity is more apparent in the West than in the East, because it's so superficial a life there. It's a very superficial life, if you notice. Between you and me, we should discuss this point, that are we being vain in our behavior? We must face ourselves. The vanity is something that is we show off. Like in our behavior, there's more chance to be vain in the West than in the East. Because the whole structure is based superficially onto the protocols of how you eat your food, how you keep your spoons, how you keep your knives, is there all this sophistication, what kind of a napkin you had, what kind of a dinner set you had, what place you have used, whether it is cheapish or it is elaborate or is sophisticated. So the whole attack, you just study it from detached mind, you study it. How much it is there, it's not needed. And the pressures of these norms work so much on people. I mean, actually people are nervous with it. If there's one dinner in an English home, I mean, they are just jumping. Because their idea is this, that if they have somebody for dinner, they should not end up with some sort of a bad name. A person can say they are unsophisticated, they were very cheapish, they were very stupid, they didn't have this, they didn't have that. I'm saying about English. I mean all the best. So they have to make extremely well elaborate arrangements, plan for it, arrange it in a proper way, that a spoon is kept properly, everything moves up properly. Even if they may not have anything, they may borrow and put it up just for a show. The whole system is such a serious matter, you see, which gives you a tremendous pressure on the mind. The artificiality of life gives you tremendous pressure. And the artificiality, if you go on seeing how much artificiality we have in the West, you will be shocked when you come to India. You will see that, see these dresses you are wearing here, it suits here. Nobody minds. They are clean. They are not dirty. Like, either they have anti-culture people who say we don't believe in artificiality, so they have all the artificial things, like, not artificial, but extra human, like lices in the head. They have bugs walking on their body. All extra human, you see, I don't know what they extra human thing. They'll be dirty people, not having baths, they'll be smelling, stinking, wearing a jean for 1 year, you see, what does it matter? Who are you? Who the hell are you to say what I wear, what I dress up like? I'll do the way I like. The other day I saw a very funny picture of a lady, quite fat, walking with a funny dress which had holes, you see, in it. So I asked her, what is this dress? She said, this is the holy dress. In that climate, I don't know why you need such a holy dress there. This is so cold that you would like to cover every part of your body. There she had holes, you know, just like diamond-shaped holes, quite big ones. You see, the trouble is, the mind, once you start moving on the artificial lines, you just go on building up yarns, you see, you don't know what to do. Now you have got dress, now we must have something different, must wear something different. So they start building up something unique, then they will have someone unique dress, then this one, first they had tail coats, now they don't have tail coats, so they must have another style, then another, the fashion, this, that, goes on and on and on and on. And I don't know where will it end. I mean, there's no end to it. So, in hairstyle, say, for in every style, they have a typical idea. Now, for example, nowadays the hairstyle they have now in the West would have been regarded as rustic in the olden days. Absolutely rustic, you see. Formerly, they used to put oil and put the hair absolutely straight like that. The Napoleonic time, then they had hair like Napoleon. Then it went on and on and on. So the attention was all as to how you appear before. Appearance was important. But while coming here, you see, people are not bothered so much about the appearances, you'll see that. Though they look nice. Because the appearance conscious people can have horrid appearances, you see, because they're so much worried about it. Now see the women in the West, because they're so much worried about their appearances, their skins become haggard, they put on all kinds of things, you know, about 5 inches of pain, things like by the time they go home, they have no time, so they try to clear it out. So this is what one has to here see, the deeper side of it, not the outer side of it. See the leaves as they are not dressed up anyway, but look so beautiful. They turn their face only to the sun and they know that getting the light is the only way to look nice. And that's what we have to learn from nature, that nature itself cleanses itself. Now you have traveled so much now, wherever it is just nature, there is no dirt, no filth, nothing. It's only the human beings when they live there, they create problems for the nature. So one has to be little bit away from these horrible norms. Of course, I don't say that you should look horrid people just coming out of jungles. You see, the other extreme can be there. We have to be in the center so that we don't go to the extremes. We should look like normal people to the people, the way we dress up, the normal, the way we have to be normal. And the pressures of this appearance business is so much that people are just drawn into that unhappy situation all the time. And if you tell them that you are looking horrid today, that person will collapse that moment. That's the worst thing you can say to them. Despite that, you see, people age very fast because of the worry that they have about the superficial. In this country, first thing you have to learn is not to be too superficial. One point. As I have told the Indians to learn a lot of things from you, I have to tell you to understand that superficiality, like saying sorry. Now sorry just is a lip service, just a lip service. Doesn't go from the heart. You see, isn't it? We say thank you. Thank you is just a lip service. Mostly. So now how to overcome the superficiality? The point comes in. It only can work out in a very simple way when we do everything from the heart, from the spirit. So whatever we are doing, we do it from the heart. Say supposing we have to meet someone. Say I have to go and see someone who is now this time a minister, who was like my brother, now he's an ex-minister. So what do I think about him? I think how he was nice to me when we were young. I was a leader and he was one of my followers that time. And then I will think about what should I take for him. That's the day of Sankranti. So I take things that are of Sankranti. Simple thing. Something nice for his wife. Could be like bangles that she would like. Nothing elaborate to show that I'm wealthier than you, I'm richer than you, I can afford to give you so. Not simple thing. Expression of your heart. Thought out things. What should we do? So you go to see them and give them something that is thought out. Now the normal behavior is there, is to go to Harrods, get some chocolates and go to a dinner party. As soon as you go there, say, hello, come in, welcome, you give them the chocolates, all right, finish. It's done, the job is done now. You earn the chocolate and sit down. Then they come and ask you, what will you have? And you ask them, and you say, you don't drink all this. And they say, then what will you have? You see, it's on and on and on. But what I'm saying, the whole process is a norm that is made, that we should go there, get some chocolates, go to the party, finished. No thought has been given. When you have heart in it, you give it a thought. We had Sahaja Yogis before who would come to see me. On the way they'll find any flowers and pick it up, bring it to me and go. It's all right, now here there are no flowers, nothing. On the road they would find some flowers, just bring it. Then they were told by some Indian people there, this is not the way. If you are coming to see the mother, go to the market, get proper flowers, give it to her. It's not the way that you meet anyone, you take it. But here, supposing you are moving about, you find flowers, all right, you can bring them to me. But where there is a thought about it, then what you do is to go around to see a flower for me. There's a thought. The thought creates the feeling that I have to give a flower to mother. Now where will I find the best flower? If that thought prevails, now this is, ours is not a thought-provoking process, you see, ours is not. But the thought which comes from the heart, it starts thinking, what should I give to mother when I'm going to see her? Anything that I find on the road, should I take it for her? Any junk I get it, some flowers I get it, some dried flowers, should I? No. Have you given a thought to anything? This is what is necessary for us to know, because in this country it is built in our tradition, we don't have to think. It's built in our tradition. Like in England they have marriages, I've seen, I don't know, maybe in every country. The boys and girls send a list of things that they would like to have. and the people select it. There's a shop where you go and buy them a finished. This is nonsense. But I say, why do they do it? He says, practical. I said, it's practical, it's very dry. But why do you do it like this? So they said, because you see, these are the things we need and that's provided for and you all make the list and it's come true and all that. But there's no thought behind it. There's no choice, nothing. And that you are asking for it is something so absurd in the very... Also that part, I mean, think from an in mind, it's absurd. And I had once a list like that and I told Supi, what's this nonsense? He said, buy one out of this and one out of your heart. You know, we won't be satisfied unless we give something of our own. And we have a Parsi community here that is very much westernized. They too have something like this, that if you go to the dinner, you see, they invited me for a wedding party. So we asked people normally, how do you do it? In some places they give money also. So I said, do they take money in Parsis? No, 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 no. So I said, what do they do? He said, very simple. You find out who is the caterer. I said, what does that mean? You see, every caterer has a fixed price. Say he is XYZ caterer, then he has a fixed price of say 22 rupees. Alright. So you go, both of you are going 44 rupees, plus you give 3 rupees more. Or 2 rupees if you want to, or if you give 44 rupees sufficient. It's a contributory dinner. And there you go, they said all the boy side people sit that side and girl side people sit this side. Whatever you have paid for, you get the money goes to the contractor. I don't know what they must be doing if somebody doesn't pay. Do they write to them that you better send money? It is an absurd situation. While you think about it. And it's very sweet. What will I give? Like the Shabari, you see, she thought, what should I give to my Ram when he comes? She must have thought. Should I give him some flowers? No, flowers, nothing. After all, flowers are nothing. That won't fill his stomach. Like a very innocent personality. She thought, I'll give him the babe. But then she must have thought, they may be sour, then what to do? She said, should I test them and see? I'll just put one tooth in it, that's all. And I will know the taste, whether they are sour or not. Whichever are sour, I'll throw away, the rest I'll give and give. And innocently she went and told, see, and in India you know how particular they are about this. There's no word for this jhootan, means the one that you have eaten something or touched something with your lip is finished in India. If you, even if a spoon, I mean like here people will take the spoon in their mouth and put in somebody else's mouth or use the same, that's not done in India. It's called as jhootan. This is a concept, which is that once you have used your hands for eating or spoon for eating, if it has touched your lips, it's jhootan. Jhootan means it's called also ushta in Marathi, and in Sanskrit language I don't know what uchisht. So whatever is like that is not eaten. So but she did it because she gave it a thought and a sweet thought, and Sri Rama enjoyed it. So in the to get over the artificiality, we must give it a thought from the heart. From the heart. Like I thought, what must they must be doing? Just I thought of it and I knew that you were meditating. I said, I better go now. See? Just a thought in the heart that makes you... So endearing, you see, everyone knows that Mother knows about us everything because you are in my thought. That's what should be the case with Sahaja Yogis. That whenever they want to do it for anyone, anything, any expression, it should not be artificial. Like shaking hands. Of course, some Indians, when they shake your hands, they take out at least 1.5 kilos of meat. But doesn't matter. They do it with the heart. They shake your hand and you'll feel, oh, Baba, what is shaking? But I've seen people shaking my hands in IMCO, in IMO, where it's horrid, I tell you this. Pass such bad vibrations that you just don't want to do it, because just a matter of their habit, or that some of them press your hand very hard, some pull that out, they don't think what's going to happen to this person. But the person here, if he shakes your hand and he just makes you quite, I mean, shaky, It is just his love. You see, the difference is the gesture is the same. One is done outside like a lip service, another is done from the heart. So if you can discriminate between these two things, then you will really have the joy. Otherwise you cannot. So we come to the point of joy. To enjoy something, just don't do it in a way that is superficial. Then there is another thing which is one should not confuse, is emotional. Emotional is not also on the, supposing somebody, a person now goes on singing, ha ha ho, ho like matka. See, that's not the way. Emotional also I do not mean. What I am meaning in the center, where there is a kind of a gesture which is balanced between emotions and understanding. That is really coming from the heart. For example, the other day I went for a program, you know that, you were all there, Andheri. And then I went away to that place where you were. I was with you for some time, then you all went away, I stayed on. And a lady came and just put both her hands around my neck, you see. And she just hugged me. And everybody was angry there. What do you mean by doing that? That is not to be done. While others have greater respect, get greater love for me, but they won't do that. So it is not emotional exuberance of things the way people do sometimes, you know. Like a saranai, you go on playing. That's not needed. What is needed is not romanticism, again, if to make it very clear. It's not romanticism expression, it's not romanticism. That's another kind of a emotional artificiality. And next day after that romance, one goes for the divorce. It's so artificial. You see, like many men who are supposed to be ladies' men and many women who are supposed to be gentlemen's ladies, they are very good at it. But it is very, very artificial. It's very cheap and it's useless, never joyful. And even if you are emotionally too much involved into something, then you cannot get joy also, because then it becomes like this, that you become possessive of the person. That, my mother, you must come to my room. Mother, I must sit next to you. If somebody is sitting 2 feet away, then he is feeling jealous of the person who is sitting 1 foot away from him. So this, what I am trying to say, even the emotional exuberance is not reality. Reality is where you really enjoy the relationship. So one side is absolute brass, what you call the rationality, artificiality. The another side is this emotional blackmail, I call it. So both the things must be done with that dignity, with that depth. And that depth, if you have, then you do things which do not look cheapish or frivolous, but look very deep and have an effect which is very deep and last and last longer. Now we have to know that we are in a very challenged position by the whole world today. That is, the whole world is in a chaos today. And we are the few who are finding out the solution. We are the captain of the ship which is going to save the world. Let's see that. We are the crew on the ship which has to save the whole world. So we have to train up ourselves like that. We have to behave in that manner. We have to have that discipline within us. Otherwise, what's the use of having some people who are just like stray dogs, sometimes barking and sometimes asking for food? We have to have really people of valor, of beauty, of understanding, of very great heights. Because Sahaja Yoga doesn't need such people who will drag it down. It needs people of dignity, people of love, people of compassion. Like Christ, was embodiment of compassion. But have you seen him hugging round to anyone? Never. There's no picture like that. I haven't seen one. At least they have done all kinds of nonsense with him, but never I've seen him hugging someone all the time. All right, when you meet, all right, men can hug men, women can hug women, express yourself. But all the time tugging on to one woman or tugging on to one man is absurd for surgery. Maybe your wife, maybe your husband doesn't look nice. It's not a very dignified picture. So the surjogis, if they have to worry about appearance, they must know from their heart that they have to be surjogis. Surjogis in every expression. Like between the two surjogis, there should be always tremendous respect. Not only respect, but tremendous respect. Then whether he is an Indian or an Englishman or a French, you can have a nice fun, little jokes here and there. But as far as the personality is concerned, you must respect. Ask others to sit down. You have the chair. You stop. But not that you go to the first seat and go and occupy one, first of all. You do. That is one thing you have to learn from Indians. They have this capacity that the way they do it, you see. And they don't think that they are rich or poor or anything. Now, I have told that today, I showed Gregor that Rajesh has got 8 or 9 factories. The one I showed him, a huge big thing like that, is the owner's son and the elder's son. But the way he was serving you food, you say, enjoy it. Probably, and nobody can believe that he's like that. Anybody, see, whether he's rich or poor or anything, there's a rapport, because all this has to be lost in Sahaja Yoga. If you still think of these artificial barriers between human beings, you can never solve the problem. So once we are dealing with them or talking to them, now I would say that we'll be going all over there also. So I would like you to make them feel comfortable with you. Of course, they'll make a big ado out of you. Don't know. So our guests, even a leper comes as a guest in India, he's treated like a god, because he said that all the guests are gods in this country. So any guest comes in the house, he's treated like that. Only in modern times, when they're finding it difficult, say in Bombay and all that, they get pestered by guests. But normally guests are to be respected whatever they do. They should be given the best thing in the house. This is the culture of this country. A guest has to be given whatever they have. You have the best in the house. It's not like this, the rest of it is kept in the fridge and just take out the stale stuff for the guest. The best that you have, you give it to the guest. And that is how it works out. When you are there, they will make a bigger draw out of you. Because this is the beginning of the tour, I'm telling you that they really spoil. Believe. Just, except for putting you on their heads, they will do everything else that is possible. Take it from. And they'll spoil you more and more. And if you are visiting third time, they'll be even worse. But in that, just feel their love. Feel them. And respect. And laughter. I hope you develop that oneness, because they are from the heart. These people are from the heart. They are villagers, simple people, from the heart. Whatever they are doing for them. It's so difficult. You know, yesterday I told them that I have to pay for the food. You see, there's a big fight going on between. This is our chance. They said, when can we feed them after? This is our chance. Why should we take away our chance, sort of thing? I mean, imagine those poor people who are there, those fishermen and fisherwomen. They wanted to feed you. This is our chance, you see. And Rajesh wanted to pay for the lights. They said, no, this is our chance. He said, now will you please put these lights? I don't want you to be indebted for this. He said, no, we have already collected money. But Rajesh could manage. He said, I am one of you. I must also contribute part of it. So the thing is, the fight is, I must do this, I must give this, I must bring this. So we have to turn a new leaf in our life of this simple beauty within ourselves, which we have, all of us have. Because we enjoy the stories, isn't it? Don't we?
when somebody's telling us the stories of this love we enjoy. So why not have it ourselves? Something surprising about human beings I've seen. That, you see, a bad woman will enjoy a film and weep when she will see another bad woman in the film torturing someone. But when she'll come home, she'll torture equally. I mean, she enjoys that. She likes it. She wants that such a woman should be corrected, but she herself won't come. It's a funny human nature. Now, when we are enjoying these stories, we have to be like that. We have to enjoy. This part we have to enjoy. And God willing, I'm sure it's going to work out this time. A much deeper love, affection, understanding between ourselves. Because inside, we are all one. We are all connected. We are all collective. Just we have to reach our depths. By little deliberations, penetration, and confrontation with yourself. And it will work out. And it's so beautiful. I mean, just to think of it, you feel so beautiful about it that, oh, it happened like that. How is it? See, certain points of enjoyment. Like I'll tell you, Ruth went to some Italian place and Sicily, I think. Where did you go, Ruth? Where you met her? Gilmet?
Yes, it was in the center of Sicily. In the center of Sicily. Huh?
They didn't know each other, you know. Just they sat in one place. And suddenly, I don't know how she discovered Ruth, and Ruth discovered her as to be Sajogi. And then they met with that love. And, I mean, they felt such nearness. I mean, they had never known each other. And you will be surprised also. When you will meet Sahyogis, you will feel that nearness much more than with any one of your religions or friends or so called. The deeper you grow into it, the better it would be. And it should work out. Now there are some new people who have come, and I would like to meet them, those who have come for the first time. Not today, because not the moonlight won't give me sufficient light to see them. So I'll meet them sometime, one by one. I would like to arrange some time that they come and see me. So tomorrow we have an arrangement that in the morning time you all get up and have your tea, and you need not take baths tomorrow because you are going to have a bath later on. take your breakfast and everything. And then you have to listen to this tape, or you go for your swim, whichever way you like. I mean, what time you think you'll be ready to go for a swim?
The tape first is better, Sri Mataji.
So morning time, after tea, you can have the tape and then the breakfast. And then you go out there and you can have your swim, bath, everything. You come back, have your lunch here. Afternoon, you rest. And then we have a public program about Kityasta Ayaplehe? Patsla. 5 o'clock we all have to gather here for this procession. That's the first procession we'll be having with the villagers. And we'll be reaching about 7 o'clock, and there will be a meeting at about 7 o'clock. We'll be over by 8 or 8:30, then we'll have our dinner. And all the program is all there, but it's better once to tell them all the program that we have. It's a very interesting program we have made. So what is after that? Can you tell them, Warren?
I told them.
Bhagavara Jevan Lavlaka, Bhagavara Jevan Lavlaka, huh? You stand up and tell them the whole.
We've been through it, Sri Mataji, completely this afternoon.
You told them?
Yes.
All of you know. So you like the program? All right. I mean, if there is any problem with the program, let me know. Only we'll have a little problem, which I must tell you. It's better to tell before than to see them. That will be when you go to Aurangabad, you see, from there. And when from Aurangabad, when you come to Rahuri, it is going to be a long journey for you. And in that long journey, maybe you may not be able to get anything to eat, I don't know, whatever it is the situation is. Because I don't know, what time you leave Aurangabad?
We'll go to Ellora, Mother, during the morning, and we'll leave at about 12. We'll have an early lunch. And
where will you have lunch?
We'll have lunch at Ellora. We'll take a packed lunch.
Packed lunch, all right. And then you will start from there. Yes. But it will take nothing short of 6 hours, the whole of afternoon, for you to reach the Rahuri. So you'll reach there in the evening time. And evening, there's no program in Rahuri. Is there any program? No. So I will try to reach Rahuri by train, I'm thinking. But it's quite far away. From Dhulia, I'll take a train and reach about in the morning time. Dara bagta ka gaadi cha kasa kaay hai? Udya sangta ka mala? Udya gaadi cha baga? Dhulia hun gaadi jar geli manje nashkala kalel barobar. Nashkala kalel. So from Dhulia, I was thinking of coming by train to Rahuri. So you can receive me at the station, they would all like to receive you. And then in Rahuri now, you see the thing is, the kind of a thing we had like this, you remember? And the Rahuri people were not happy, they thought that you were not very comfortable there and all that. So now they have a Lagnagar the same way, you have got this Gokul type. But I don't know, if you like the other stuff, you can do it next trip. This kind of a thing that you had for staying. That was not so comfortable though. The bathrooms and all that were not so good. Alright, you see this place. If you don't like this one, you would like to go to the same village sort of a thing. You can do it.
I'm sure Dumal's got the best thing for us.
Yes, but you see, we Indians, well, not being to the West, have funny ideas about comfort. To us, a house made of cement is the ideal. I mean, that's the maximum, the greatest luxury. What to do? Because you have lived through cement. You haven't yet. You have to live through it still.
I think Jamal wants to give us cement, Sri Mataji.
That's a cement place. Absolutely, I must tell you. That's a real cement. Without any stone whatsoever. Take it from me. No doubt, I'm sure of it. Because that's the greatest luxury for Indians to have. You know, the stone floor is much cheaper than the cement floor in this country. Yes, it is. It's absurd. For example, a terracotta is much more expensive than cotton. You must take some cotton shirts. They cost you about 40 to 45 rupees. But if you want to take a terracotta shirt, it will cost you 150 rupees. But this is a funny country, no? In this respect, upside down. As I was telling him that we want to have huts for you, and absolutely huts. But still they say, Mother, why do you want to torture their life? What to do? I was telling Gregor and Navarre, you better talk to Dumal about it. Because he thinks I'm trying to, you see, put you to ordeals by putting you in the huts. But what to do now? I told him, Baba, they like it. They would love it to have this. No, 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 that's an ordeal. Now, how to deal with them? You see, the point is, they are on the other side of it. So you better tell them that if Mother wants to have the hut, no, we want to have the huts, not Mother, because if I say Mother, then finished. And even thatched roof, you said we'd love to have. Tell them.
Yeah.
You like thatched roof?
Yeah, that's nice.
They will all put their hands to their heads and sit down. But don't tell them I've given you the ideas. Jana gavtacha hai avadto. Chappar. Ata aplyala gavtacha chappar ghatla to tumhi mnal kai yancha kai kelis nahi jab. Aplyakade cement chasla mhanje apan samajto phar jala. Ani yanchakade gavtacha ankin yacha bas asto na apla. That's the bamboo. That's the other color. ते फार चांगलं आपलं यांच्यासाठी. ते केलं तर उत्तम, पण आपल्याला ते समजत नाही. आपल्याला सिमेंट वाटतं विशेष आहे. आता आहे की नाही उलट डोकं, त्यांचं किंवा आपलं दोघांपैकी कोणाचं तरी आहे. I said we have upside down brains, either theirs or ours, but they like something that you really don't think much of it. So I think that's true.
Oh yes,
that's the best.
Huh? Yeah. That's the solution. I drew something for Gregor and I showed him today what sort of a thing I have an idea. That Mira will have three types of huts, one small, one bigger and one bigger. And the kind of thing we'll have there. But this time we'll not be going that way. What a unfortunate thing. I wanted you all to go that way because you haven't seen these old temples. And I don't know how to...
We could do a detour from Rauri, Mother.
Huh?
We could do a detour from Rauri.
Yeah, that's very funny road. You can only do it from Pandharpur to Pune. Mm. But it's not that way, Jesse, is it?
No, it's not true. Mm.
From Pandharpur, where do we go?
We go down to
Kolhapur.
Kolhapur and then up to Pune through Satara.
But how many days are we in Pune?
On the way Satara, we could do it. We could go inland more at Satara. No.
See, the road is only if you go to Pandharpur, from Pandharpur to Pune, it's on that way. Belapur, which is a very interesting place, and what an old temple we have there. And they will be able to see where we are going to the station. We can do one thing.
How many people have seen the place of the temple at Sangam? How many people have actually seen
the place at Sangam?
The place at Sangam, where we walked through the river.
And we swam afterwards.
And we swam afterwards.
Oh. Yeah. Oh, most of them have not. Just raise them higher. Not even one third.
Correct.
One fourth people. So we can see how we can arrange it that way, see? You come back to Pune on what date?
8 February. 8
February.
8
and 9.
The program at Satara on the 7th and we come back to Pune on the 8th.
From Satara?
Yes. Before that we're at Malapeth on the 6th.
That is different line altogether. But from Pune, just to see this place, you can go. Mm. You see, when we arrive at Pune, yes, you can go to this place. Karan, sky Pune la program, pahila dishi, donas dias program hai.
8th, 9th and 10th, Sri Mataji. 10th we leave to go to Bodhi.
What time?
Midday. We leave midday on the 10th to go to Bodhi.
मग ह्या 3 दिवसात 1 दिवस जाऊ शकतो. इट विल टेक फॉर यू टू गो देअर अँड कम बॅक फ्रॉम पुणे. किती 40 मैल आहे ना? 40-45 मैल फार जवळ आहे. यू कॅन गो फ्रॉम पुणे टू बेलापूर अँड कम बॅक, जस्ट टू गो अँड सी द प्लेस अँड कम बॅक.
Either the 8th or 9th. On the 9th, probably.
9th, I think they are having a program in Akurdi or someplace. Yes, we are going to some villages. So we'll put it one of these days that you can go and see and come back. Hey, Baravi. Because you would like to go and see the place, isn't it?
Yes.
सकाळीच पाठवून दिलं ना समजा तर बेलापुरलांचं जेवण होऊ शकतं. बेलापुरलांच्या जेवणाची व्यवस्था होऊ शकते. तुम्हाला जर निरोप केला तर बेलापुरलांचं जेवण होऊ शकतं. दे कॅन सी द ओल्ड टेम्पल, व्हेरी ओल्ड, इट्स द वन ऑफ द ओल्डेस्ट टेम्पल. यस, हा, दॅट्स इट. नशिबाज, आय थिंक सो ओल्ड आहे सर. आय मीन यू कॅन्ट फाईंड सच ओल्ड टेम्पल इन द टुरिस्ट प्लेसेस. यू सी, very beautiful temple they have. I mean, it's a very old one. So I think would be nice idea that we go to Pune, and in Pune you cut short your stay there one day. Mm-hmm. I'll tell the Pune people to make some lunch for you. You can go and have as a picnic
make
there.
Make it as a day trip.
Huh?
Make it as a day trip.
Day trip there. Mm-hmm. Have a look at it and come back and have your dinner.
That's great.
You can do it on the 8th, I think, because 9th they want to have for Akurdi. पुण्याला हळा पूजन नाही आहे. देस नो पूजा इन पुणा दिस टाइम, इज इट?
नो
पूजा,
नो पूजा.
हां, मग असं करा तुम्ही, बघा पेरेकर, पुण्याला 8, 9 आणि 10 आहे, बरं का? लावलं का जेवण?
लावलं.
बरं, 8, 9 आणि 10. आता 8 त्याच्यातलं जे आहे त्या अँड देन टू बोडी.
Jagannatha Sri Nirmala Devi
Ki Jai.
Now about marriages also you have to decide. Yeah.
Decide.
'Seek the highest, they live with whatever they have with satisfied souls. But that sometimes can be very much detrimental to their growth as spiritual people. I should say, also certain things that have happened in this country is that we got English education from the English, and the so-called education of English has ruined our young people very much. Our young people have become frivolous and they do not know what the English themselves are now up to. They don't understand how the English are now seeking God and our young people are not seeking God. So there are many such things that happen in a society due to the imbalances in the political situations. And our country has lost a lot of goodness, depth and understanding of God because we were slaves for 300 years. So the people are slavish very much as far as the Western life is concerned. And the attitude towards Western life is that of complete surrender. So they don't understand what you people have suffered in that Western culture, and it is for you to point it out to them that they should not take to that culture which does not give you assent. And I would request you people to talk to our young people here whenever you have a chance to go to the universities and colleges and tell them that our main achievement is that we have a possibility of achieving God easily because we are brought up that way. All our traditions, you see, in the cities and the people where they are affected by Western education is very much ruined, and the people do not have that capacity to come up to understanding that whatever we had was something very precious and is not to be lost. It's a very sad affair. And sometimes you must be also shocked the way
the young people of this country behave towards the ancient heritage that we had. Now, today's program showed them that you had something to offer them to announce in the atmosphere you had went, and to enjoy that announcement. I wish they would learn these things from you and would take life more seriously, because they have become frivolous due to this introduction of outside culture on them. Even our cinemas and our all entertaining capacities are full with such ideas that make them absolutely bloat into ego-oriented societies and to float on the superficial life and think that is enjoyment. They have lost their depth. Very surprising that they have lost their depth and their understanding of our deeper significance of Indian life. Now, as you see, the country is going to dogs, and we have to do a lot to awaken our young people in the villages, young people in the cities, and the people who are not at all concerned as to what is happening. They are not bothered as to what is around them. Have to be brought to the reality to see that what is their purpose of life and what they can do here. They are all dharmic on the whole, you can see, but there is no movement. They are static in their whole approach towards life. So I'm very thankful for all this that we enjoy, and I wish all the people of this country, also those who are of your age group, should also enjoy the same way, but they cannot because they haven't found their spirit. It's very sad that they should not, while you should, and I feel that they also should do it. Though I have worked very hard outside, much more, I've spent much more time outside, and that was my due, I think. But now I'll be coming back to India and will be working for this country and for its emancipation. And I'm sure all of you will come down to help me to work it out in this great country of yoga. May God bless you. ही मंडळी इथे 14 देशातून आलेली आहे आणि तुमच्या देशामध्ये काहीतरी विशेष आहे या महाराष्ट्रात काहीतरी विशेष आहे हे जाणून आले ते डोळे मिटून आलेले नाही त्यांच्यामध्ये मोठे मोठे डॉक्टर्स आहेत सायंटिस्ट आहेत शिकलेले लोक आहेत हे काय रस्त्यावरनं उठलेले लोक नाही आणि ह्या देशात ते का आले असं जर त्यांना विचारलं तर ते तुमच्यापेक्षा जास्त जाणतात की ह्या देशाचं वैशिष्ट्य काय त्याला कारण म्हणजे माझा जन्म ह्या देशात झाला इतकंच नव्हे तर हा देश फार मोठा देश आहे त्याला आपण योगभूमी असं म्हणतो ह्या देशाला त्याची दुर्दशा बाह्यातनं दिसते पण आतून हा देश इतका मोठा आहे की जर आपण ह्याची खरोखर संपत्ती मिळवली आणि त्या संपत्ती